So the bill before us today deals with legislation which, first I want to clarify, this bill does not in any way prevent the Champlain Hudson Power Express line. What it does is it basically sets some standards here to say that if the New York State, a public benefit authority, the New York State Power Authority, were to contract to bring power, then they would also ensure that they allow in-state existing generating facilities located throughout our state to have that opportunity to transmit their electricity across such transmission lines. Now, the CHPE has been on the books and proposed for a number of years. There have been some staggering costs associated with this. Some estimates have been over $2 billion. So the concern again here is that if our power authority were to engage in any type of a contract for this type of activity and service through our state, what we want to do to bring power, we want to ensure that we're not enabling a subsidy, which would in the end potentially cause additional increases on our taxpaying ratepayers.
Senator Squadron, why do you rise?
If the sponsor would yield for a question.
Will the sponsor yield for a question?
I would.
Senator Squadron.
The sponsor says that this would in no way shut down the Champlain-Hudson transmission line. However, I believe the bill says that it would do exactly that if the conditions in the bill aren't met. Isn't that correct?
No, Senator Squadron. What it says, I indicated that earlier in the explanation, that it only if the New York's public, the New York Power Authority, is to engage in a contract with this specific line, that we would like equal opportunity and access to in-state generators to have that ability to hook up to that line, because you now have a public benefit entity involved in trying to bring power. We believe that there are a number of opportunities and potential sources that exist also that will be able to provide the power, because I know there's a concern. We want to ensure that power is provided where needed, particularly in the city. In one way, what this language and bill kind of does is to codify some of the Article 7 transmission line certificate that exists to protect the ratepayer also. So they can build the line, but if they want to engage in some type of public connection through a public subsidy, if you want the power authority to engage in that, that's where we would say that we want to ensure that also we allow the in-state generators to have that type of access. In the early 90s, the power authority entered into contracts with Hydro-Quebec, and they subsequently were canceled because they were too expensive. So we're trying to just monitor this from a cost perspective and to be mindful to the ratepayer across the region and the state as a whole.
The sponsor will continue to yield.
Yes.
I remind all members to please direct their comments through the chair and not to an individual member. The sponsor continues to yield. Senator Squadron.
Thank you. Is the sponsor aware of any plans for the power that's going to be transmitted over this line to be currently purchased by NYPA? And if not, sort of under what circumstances does the sponsor imagine, you know, consider that that might happen?
Through you, Senator Squadron. First of all, in the bill on lines 3, 4, and 5, you can see some of what I discussed previously. But my concern is, in the past, NYPA has been a part of some costly transmission projects. We look at the Hudson Transmission Project, which was a line that ran for about 7 miles between Ridgefield, New Jersey, under the Hudson to Hell's Kitchen. And because of the lack of buyers for the power, for that power, NYPA lost $43.1 million. As I indicated earlier, in the early 90s, they had another contract which subsequently was canceled. So the concern is there's a past history here, and not to be reactive, but to be proactive, we are trying to be mindful of this type of potential interaction, and we are suggesting that if they were to get involved, if they're not to get involved, and it's a private sector venture, then it is what it is. But if they are to get involved with public dollars, then we're saying that if you're going to engage in a contract, we want to ensure that we allow in-state generators to have access to that line.
If the sponsor continues to yield.
Yes.
The sponsor continues to yield.
So to understand the purpose of this bill, it is to prevent the New York Power Authority from accessing the power on this transmission line in the event it wants to, and instead give preference to power producers largely upstate, such as the producers owned by Exelon?
No, that's not true. Mr. President, through you, Senator Squadron, no, that is not accurate. Again, what the bill attempts to do is to ensure that if the power authority is to engage in a contract, then they would allow access to that line for in-state generators. We have over $10 billion that have been invested by some of these in-state generators. We have over 10,000 employees working for them across the state. So we're just saying that if you're going to use public dollars, which potentially could have an adverse impact on the ratepayer, and I cited some of the previous examples, and that's why we're looking at this from a proactive standpoint rather than a reactive, then we just need to be cognizant of that and say, if you engage in this, then you have to allow access to those lines to these in-state power generators.
Sponsor continue to yield.
Will the sponsor yield?
Yes.
Senator Squadron.
Thank you. If there's no capacity on those lines under the scenario, what would the impact be?
Mr. President, through you, I don't believe that's an issue, but I'm not aware that that is an issue in any way. And in fact, as I look at this, when we look at the requirement, if NYPA were to engage in some type of contract, then what the request would be, it would be in-state power generation, they would have to agree to at least one cutoff where these in-state power generators can put their power into the line and carry it down to the city.
Sorry, if the sponsor would just repeat, I apologize.
It would at least, what we're suggesting, you asked like what it would entail. If NYPA were to engage in a contract, and what we're requiring is that they must agree to include at least one cutoff from where the line, where the in-state power generators would have the opportunity to put their power into this line to carry it down to the city.
Sponsor will continue to yield.
Yes.
Sponsor yield, Senator Squadron.
And that requirement would exist regardless of the relative cost of the power generated by the in-state power generators and the relative to the purchase price in the NYPA contract.
I think that, Mr. President, through you, Senator Squadron, I think that has to be determined. I think the effort that we're trying to seek here, Senator Squadron, is to ensure we protect the ratepayer, the taxpayer, that we don't want to enable a contract that puts public dollars into something that could potentially increase those rates. So that's the concern that we have using a public benefit authority in this particular instance. If the line, and as I indicated, there obviously is some concerns and issues with the line from a private perspective because it's been several years and the costs are staggering. So we're just trying to determine what is the best approach here to deliver the power. And as I indicated to you earlier, there are a number of other possible scenarios and sources that may also exist and that are evolving each and every day of where we can generate and deliver that power to where it's needed, particularly in light of some of the decisions that are being made in facilities such as Indian Point.
Sponsor, continue to yield.
Sponsor yield, Senator
Squadron.
So just
to be clear, are there any protections in the bill to suggest that this access would only be provided if it were to reduce rates, reduce costs for ratepayers? Or is it an automatic access to this transmission line regardless as to whether that would increase costs for ratepayers?
Yeah, Mr. President, through you, Senator Squadron, there's nothing specific in the bill, but the intent of the bill is to ensure, as I indicated to you, that we try to do whatever's possible to avoid costs that could be passed along ultimately to the ratepayer. That's the goal and the objective. Obviously, we want to get the power there, and we want to do it in the most efficient manner possible and in the most cost-effective manner possible.
Bill, Mr. President.
Senator Squadron on the bill.
Thank you. I really appreciate the sponsor answering the questions and actually do better understand the intent of the bill than I did before, so it was time well spent. I do have an ongoing concern about the bill. While I think it is clear that this bill is not intended to make the $2 billion or $2.2 billion investment in the Champlain Hudson Power Express moot or lie fallow, which I do appreciate. I think it still does tie the hands of NYPA, obviously, it's in fact the intent, and more importantly, could have the consequence of either increasing costs for ratepayers in places like Long Island and parts of New York City that already have very, very high rates and whose rates need to be protected as Indian Point is phased out, just as the sponsor says. One major concern is we know that a lot of the power that is currently projected to be generated in the upstate part of New York is generated by a set of nuclear generating facilities owned by Exelon, Fitzpatrick, Janae, and 9 Mile, 1 and 2, that are currently slated to get up to $7.6 billion in subsidy over the next decade plus, dwarfing the $2.2 billion that we're getting out of this transmission line to access Quebec's power. And to make the downstate region more dependent on power that requires nearly $8 billion in subsidy that the ratepayers across the state are going to have to pay is real concerning. There are lots of different ways to protect ratepayers, to make the ratepayers of Nassau and Suffolk and New York City and the Hudson Valley more dependent on power that requires a subsidy of nearly $8 billion is not the way to do it. So I do understand, and in fact I'm sympathetic to, having dealt with them a couple of times, the need to hold NYPA's feet to the fire and protect ratepayers when NYPA is involved from time to time. But I have to tell you, protecting ratepayers is not tying the hands of the regulators so that they are required to make a region of the state more dependent on heavily, heavily, heavily subsidized power that is already projected to raise energy costs significantly across the state. So I worry a lot about that. I also do worry about the ability for NYPA to come in if it needs to quickly. And for those two reasons, Mr. President, I'll be voting no. I would be interested in working with the sponsor further on ensuring that NYPA doesn't come in and create higher price power through its contracting, which I know is a legitimate concern, but also that we do not even further burden the ratepayers across the state with the enormous subsidy that is currently projected to be driven into a couple of these producers in one region. So I'm a no, Mr. President. Thank you.